Thank you very much. First of all, I have to thank the invitation of Emanuele Marini to this conference, because without him it wouldn't have been possible for me to come here. The presentation I'm going to give today is a presentation on pure linguistics, but yes, I can do it. It's on pure linguistics, but anyway, I'll try it to be related to what all you do. It's polyglots, and well, also because I'm a polyglot as well. I'm dubbed towards an ontological theory of language, so I'm going to talk a little bit about radical minimalism, mimetic linguistics, and linguistic engineering. Maybe you don't know anything about that. But anyway, I will tell you what this is. This is the research I'm doing at the Max Planck Institute for Psycholinguistics in Nijmegen, the place where I live nowadays. But I'm originally Peruvian. I come from Lima, so my native language is Spanish. And also at Harvard University in Nijmegen, where I have my office. Okay. The picture you can see here is the Cum Panama stone. This is where everything started. I am a field linguist, which means that I'm not an armchair linguist. I am a linguist that works with languages in the field, in the Amazon, in the Andes, and also in the region called Tierra del Fuego, or Fire Island, in the southernmost part of South America. Here I can show you some of the pictures of my research. Well, this is South America. And this is all the, this is the region where I work. It's the upper Amazon, and I also work with Andean languages spoken in all these zones, and with a language, spoken here, which is called Selknam, a language that nowadays has only a single speaker. When I was working with that language, it had actually two speakers, but during my fieldwork trip, one of them passed away, sadly. And that is actually what's happening, not only here in Europe, but also in South America and in many places around the world. And the task, this urgent task in linguists have is, well, to describe these languages and leave at least a description of them for further studies in the field and also for the preservation of the languages, at least in written terms, right? Well, they cannot be revitalized anymore. It's kind of dark, right? But okay, this is what I do. This is one of my main informants in the upper Amazon. This is Alfredo. He's a speaker of the Shawi language. The Shawi language is a Kawapanan language spoken by approximately 21,000 speakers in the Peruvian region called Loreto, which is in the north. And this is what I do. I normally work with Shawi people like this. He's also Victor, one of my other main consultants in the region. I'm currently writing a grammar of this language, but also I did that before with other two languages. So, well, I just wanted to show you my pictures and show you what I do as a linguist. These are the last two speakers of Selknam. Nowadays we just have one because Mrs. Herminia Vera passed away during my fieldwork trip. I wrote a grammar of this language, and you can all have a copy of it if you go to academia.edu. You can download it from there, and you can learn a little bit of Selknam if you want to add a new weird language to your language list. It's www.academia.edu, and you have just to type my name there, and you will find my profile, and you can download the grammar from the site. Well, this is what I do, but everything started here. This is a small village called Canoa Puerto in the upper Amazon. I went there for the first time 2.5 years ago to work with the Shawi language. I was a Peruvian young guy from the Peruvian bourgeoisie. And obviously that was very tough for me. I had to get used to the Shawi way of living, and I was really frustrated. I had a very big cultural shock. And I was very sad, and I sat there near a stone, and I talked to Cum Panama. Cum Panama is the Shawi god. And I told him, hey, Cum Panama, if you actually exist, what should I do? What am I here? Am I gonna survive? And well, in the same terms as Carol yesterday, I won't tell you what he told me, but I will tell you something that's been happening during my research in the last 2.5 years. And I will start with a phrase of someone I really admire, was Heraclitus. He said something like, well, this is in an old Greek, ancient Greek, for the mois, los autois environment, de kai book environment, amen te kai uke amen te, which means something like, people can never step again onto the same river. So you will always see a river, and even if you step twice, three, four times, the river will never be the same, and you will never be the same as well. And this is actually something that happens with language. We always speak about different languages, but they are never the same. They always change. Language change is a universal property among the languages of the world. But not many people take care about language change. They think that languages are static, that languages don't change. And I'm going to talk also about that today. So the outline for my presentation is, I want to present some basic ideas which have been Evans and Levinson 2009. This is like one of the big articles in linguistics nowadays, so it's like, I would say it's a paradigm change in linguistics in the last years due to this article, so I will give you just a little overview of what's been said. I will present also the current debate in linguistics. What are the main three questions that we have to tackle in linguistic research nowadays? What's the difference between ontology and morphology? Because, well, you read in the title that I'm going to talk about an ontological theory of language. So what is ontology and what's the difference between ontology and morphology? What is the nature of language? And I'm going to say something about, just a little bit, about radical minimalism, mimetic linguistics, then what I call the new linguistics, and also some conclusions. Well, I'm going to say something about hyperpolyglots as well. So, what are Evans and Levinson's ideas? Well, they said, we are the only known species whose communication system varies fundamentally in both form and content. And that is actually true. Humans are the only animals in the world that have a special communicative system, which is language. No other animal has it, at least in the way humans do. And, well, I agree with this statement. They also say that language is a bicultural hybrid, and it happened because of what they call a gene culture evolution. So what actually happens is that we all have language, which is genetically encoded in our, somewhere in our DNA, but we also, or our language is changed due to culture. We all have different cultures, and that culture difference will be conceptualized in different ways depending on the languages we speak. So there is a co-evolution. There's genetic, so we all human beings share that, but there's also something different, which is cultural, and that is expressed in these momentum by a cultural hybrid. There are approximately 7,000 communicative systems around the world. So there are 7,000 languages, so we are very far from learning all of them if we are polyglots, right? There are 7,000 different languages in the world. And they are all different in terms of culture, in terms of grammar. Some of them are nominative accusative languages, some of them are active stative languages, or some ergative absolutive languages. I don't know if you know these terms, but you can check them if you are grammar geeks. And also the number of language families is crucial to search for universals. So if we want to look at language universals, so what is universal to the language phenomenon, we have to look at all the languages of the world, which is kind of a difficult task, because we first of all have to describe all the languages that exist, and that is a very, very difficult from a practical point of view. So, if we look at these 7,000 different languages, what we see is that there are no sound universals, so languages are completely different in terms of phonetics and phonology. There is no syllable structure universals, no morphological universals, no universal word classes, no syntactic universals, no semantic universals. So languages are completely diverse. They are not the same. So even if you know the grammar of one language and you afterwards see a language such as Tagalog or a language spoken in Africa or a language spoken in Amazon, you will see that, oh, this language doesn't have nouns, how come? Well, it's very normal, actually, when you are a field linguist and you see all these weird languages. But they are not weird, they are just languages, which is very important. Well, so I more or less agree with these ideas. What is the current debate in linguistics? In linguistics, there are two main schools actually tackling all these problems. The school started a functionalist school, which was actually born here in Europe, and the formalist school, which was born in Europe and in America. These slides were taken from Shibatani, 2012. So the functional school is based on an empiricist philosophy, so an experience. While the formal school is mostly based in a rationalist philosophy, in a Cartesian philosophy. Big names in the functional school are Aristotle, well, also Francis Bacon, John Locke, David Hume. And in the formal school we have Socrates, Plato, Descartes, Gottfried Leibniz, Thomas Spinoza, and many others formal philosophers. The main idea in the functional school is that the knowledge is acquired through sensory experience. So, in the terms, in the case of languages, we will all acquire the languages based in the experiences we had in our lives. But, so this is a tabula rasa, the blind slate hypothesis that many people like. We are born, we don't know anything, we learn everything from experience. But in the formal school, they believe in innate ideas. So we are born with a universal grammar, maybe. A universal grammar that lets us learn all the languages which are outside, and we learn because of experience. And so it's an inborn universal knowledge. This is what Chomsky called the UG, the universal grammar hypothesis. In our discipline in linguistics, well, I would say in my discipline, I don't know how many of you are linguists too, but in my discipline, in terms of functionalism, the language ability is part of a general cognitive apparatus. So there are many things in the brain which help you learn language or languages, okay, your main language or different natural languages. Well, in the formalist school, what formalist linguists believe is that there's an inborn unique language faculty called universal grammar. In functionalism, everything is embedded in a cognitive and social-cultural context, while in formalism there is a language autonomy. So it is as if universal grammar was a single module in the brain. Okay. Also in functionalism, we see that linguistic structures are functionally motivated and shaped by use. So language will also always change because of use. While language in formalism is independent of use and function. So language is just something in the brain, and we don't even care about what's happening outside. It's just a universal capacity. Functionalism uses the inductive method, and formalism the deductive method. But there is a problem with these two schools, because when we do science, I think we have to use both, not just one. So this is really weird for the science. Indeed, in science, you always use deductive and inductive methods at the same time, but in linguistics, they were completely separated, and they were competing all the time. So I always thought there's something going wrong with this. Today's schools of linguistics are the following. You can read them, I won't read them because there are a lot. But you can see that many of them were inspired by Chomsky in the case of the formalist schools. And the functional schools were mostly inspired by Joseph Greenberg, an American linguist. A very well-known linguist for the Amerindian proposal or the Afro-Asiatic proposal, which is very, very famous nowadays. And I don't know if you know, but many of the African languages grammars are always mentioned Greenberg, at least in one page. Okay, and these are other models which are more or less in the middle. So you can see them, you can see some formal properties in them and also some functional properties. But indeed, what are the main three questions that any linguist has to ask his or herself? First of all, what is language? What are languages? So what are natural languages? And also, what are languages used for? In the case of the first question, what is language? I mean, what is the language capacity? What is this capacity we all have in our brains and we were born with? In the case of the second question, I mean natural languages, I mean languages, for example, English now, or all the other languages you speak. And in the case of the third one, what language is used for? Are they used for communication? Are they used for this, for that? Are they used for mathematical thinking, for rational thinking, or for simply thinking, etc. So what Evans and Levinson say is that the human language processing system is a hybrid, a biological system tuned to a specific linguistic system, itself a cultural historical product. So what Evans and Levinson say is that there's actually no difference between these two things. They just mix them all, and they say that there is a hybrid. But they never answer the question. And that is actually a problem, because when we want to have a science, we have to answer what the object of study of our science is. But in linguistics, this hasn't been done in the last 200 years. It has always been skipped. You know, and we just study the history of one language and we write the grammar of this language, but we never know, until now, we don't know what language is. So linguistics cannot be considered a science in that sense. Okay, so this is where ontology and morphology come. What is ontology and what is morphology? Ontology is the study of the being itself. So what is something? What? Well, morphology is the study of what constitutes the being, or how the being is constituted. Modern linguistics just study morphology, either in functionalism or either in formalism. In formalism, they looked at languages and they proposed a universal grammar, but they look at the form of languages. In functionalism, they say, well, we will look at the languages and we will say there are no sound universals, there are no universals at all. But they were always looking at the form of model languages, but they never said what language was. So there's actually no science called linguistics. And this is really a problem. This is completely empty. And when I was thinking there in the mountain, I thought, yeah, I'm not a scientist. Yeah? I'm just an enthusiast if I ask myself this question. So this is where everything started. What is the nature of language? Well, we see, well, according to Evans and Levinson, languages change, languages are socially, culturally relevant, language information is stored in the mind, and languages are processed by a complex cognitive system. That's what we all think as linguists. But this doesn't say anything about the nature of language, but this says something about what languages do. So languages help. Where are languages stored and these things, but you never know what language is. That's why maybe like 100 years ago this question was banned in France. But what we actually know about the nature of language is that language exists. That's all. That's the only thing we know about language. Language exists in our minds. We use it every day, but it exists. And that is the main main condition in order to have a science, to admit that what you actually study exists, otherwise you're doing pseudoscience, right? And that is Diego Krivokan, an Argentinian linguist, was thinking about for a long time. And he proposed a theory called radical minimalism, which is more or less a formal theory of language, but that tackles the question of what language is, which is really interesting. So, if language actually exists, language is a physical system, thus ruled by principles that govern the universe. And it's like, well, that sounds like science fiction, but this is true. Indeed, if language, the language capacity, I'm not talking about natural languages, if language exists, then of course it has to be ruled by principles that govern the universe in our minds. So it is something like a computational system. A computational system which generates complexity from simplex objects, both derivational and constraint restricted. This is something very common in what is called optimality theory. I don't know if any of you, well, if you were linguists, you would know what I'm talking about, but you can skip that. But which has a basic property called concatenation. Concatenation which holds if and only if a fully interpretable object, what we have called a face, following Chomsky in 1998, is recognized by an interpretative system, in the case of language, either phonology or semantics, and transferred to, it is taken by that system. So it's an iterative process, a process of linking. Concatenation is that. It's like a computational process. We all have that computational process in our minds. And that computational process is just human. For instance, a fish has also a computational process that permits the fish to swim and to look for food. Chimps also have another computational system which helps them, I don't know, interact with other chimps. Be selfish, etc. Read Tom Marcello's book on that if you're interested. And human beings have another type of computational system which helps them interact with one another, but also use something which is really beautiful that is called language. Hence, this human language computational system, from now on HLCS, is not language dependent. So it's not dependent on natural languages. It's something that we are born with. It's mental, biological, and physically driven. But it has nothing to do with culture. Okay, so this is radical minimalism. Mimetic linguistics, and this is something mine, something I'm publishing. Well, it's in press now. It's an article which is in press. I can send it to you if you want. Just send me an email. What mimetic linguistics says is that languages exist, and if languages exist, as this human language computational system does, then languages are also physical. It's like, oh, how can languages be physical? Well, languages, French, English, Spanish, or whatever, Ruthenian, Serbian, and all these languages you speak here, are in your mind, and if they are in your mind, they have to have a physical nature, otherwise they wouldn't exist. This can be either electrical impulses in the brain, but they actually exist, and they are transmitted from one person to another when we communicate. They are also driven by universal phenomena, and this universal phenomena is natural selection, concatenation to natural selection. So languages change, languages evolve, and this doesn't mean that there are better languages on weak languages. No, natural selection just means that one language property will adapt better to a single environment. So for instance, if a language does not adapt to globalization, it will eventually disappear, which is actually happening with South American languages, which is universal. And languages might be composed of memes. Memes are units of cultural transmission or cultural genes produced only by humans through imitation. What is imitation? Imitation is not, I don't know, for example, Emanuele has a very, he laughs in a very interesting way. He's like, right? Emanuele always laughs like that. And that's not imitation, that's just copying, right? But when we imitate, we actually take something from another, and we try to add our own spices to that attitude or to that phenomenon. So that happens with language. We learn languages ourselves. We're not just repeating the same sentences we heard before. We add more things. That is imitation. And the only living species that have imitation are human beings. So thus, languages are mimiplexes. So one single language is composed of many, many memes, which can be either they're in competition to get copied, so that the successful ones will be those of high fidelity, high fecundity, and longevity. And these mimiplexes obviously are composed of phonetic memes, phonological memes, morphological memes, syntactic memes, pragmatic memes, humor memes, idiophonic memes, etc. But they are all memes, language memes. So how language memes replicate? Well, from brain to brain, through imitation. When we communicate, when we write a book, when we read literature, when we read poems, when we say something to someone, etc. And how does this happen? Well, as polyglots, you all know how you learn languages. You copy things, you imitate things, actually, and you repeat it, but you always add something which is very personal. That's why languages change. And also you can ask historical linguists, who have been studying this phenomenon for more than 200 years, psycholinguist, social linguist, discourse analyst, etc. So actually, mimetic linguist would be the linguistics which would eventually suppress all these other linguistics and just use the information they were using before. Okay? But this is just a small summary. If you want to know more, just read the article. Okay? So the new linguistic. I like this picture, this brain. We have a computational system, hence the human language computational system. And we also have 7,000 languages in the world. This thing is obviously studied by radical minimalism. Obviously, it can be studied by any other theory, but from my point of view, I think that radical minimalism is a very good candidate, and it's an ontological theory of language. If you want to tackle the question, what languages and what languages are, we need ontological theories. We have to leave morphological theories apart. And in terms of all the languages, I think the best one would be mimetic linguistics. But of course, it's my theory. All the theories can appear and tackle the same question as well. But they obviously have to be ontological in its nature as well. So mimetic linguistics. And this is radical minimalism, sorry. And what we can see is, well, that actually natural languages are learned by people. But the only way people learn these languages is because they have this HCLS processor. Otherwise, they wouldn't be able to do it. They wouldn't be able also to learn music or to learn math, because the HCLS language component is the one in charge to make us be human. You know, chimps cannot do complex mathematics as well. This is a part of the language capacity too. So there has to be a linguistics, a branch of linguistics, which has to study the interaction in between mimetic linguistics and radical minimalism, or in between language means and the HLCS language capacity. And that is what Krivohan and me, we have dubbed that linguistic engineering. Linguistic engineering would be a branch of linguistics that actually sees the interaction in between these two big branches of the discipline. But this is something to be developed. There was a very good theory called optimality theory. I already talked about that some minutes ago, which tackled this same question, which could be a good candidate for linguistic engineering, but we still have to check it with the authors, because they were based also in generative grammar, and generative grammar is the morphological theory of language. So, some conclusions. But my presentation is not finished yet. Former theories of language proposed a model of language based on the morphology of actual languages. So that is what I have already told you. A theory of language must account for the ontology of language and languages. And that is what radical minimalism and mimetic linguistics do. The morphology of language is just one. The morphology of HLCS is just one encapsulation. But the morphology of languages, of natural languages, is extremely diverse, because all languages have to adapt to its processor, HLCS, and also they have to adapt themselves to specific cultures and to specific needs of the speakers. Well, finally, Pake Evans and Levinson, in peace with Evans and Levinson, you know, not contra, I don't like that word, which is very controversial, and also because Levinson is a supervisor. Language is not a hybrid, biological plus cultural. We're dealing with two different things, a physical language system called HLCS, and physical mimetic systems called languages, both driven by natural selection, biologically and culturally, respectively. So this is what we have by now in as an ontological theory of language, which is actually very simple. It's not very complex, it's very, very simple. But no linguist has said this before. This is actually very controversial, because how come, right? It seems stupid, actually. But well, before I go back to polyglots, when I was there in the stone, you know, and I was talking to Kumpanama, I was looking at the rainforest, and I was thinking, well, what am I going to do here? And, well, actually, Kumpanama never replied. But I saw a flock of toucans leaving the rainforest. And I said, yeah, this is what I'm going to do. I'm not going to be an armchair linguist anymore. I will work with the Shawis and I will try to revitalize language. I will try to describe languages. I will try to be a more a linguist more related to people. And that is why I'm here as well. Because, well, I was a polyglot. I am a polyglot indeed. And I was always isolated in my armchair learning languages. But I think that if we are interested in languages, which we have to communicate. And that's why I brought this presentation to all of you. The hyperpolyglot brain. The hyperpolyglot brain, and I'm not talking about the polyglot brain, because as Alex has already presented today in the morning, everyone is eventually capable of becoming a polyglot. And yeah, I agree, it's true. Everyone can become a polyglot, but maybe not hyperpolyglots. And I would like to be mean, but this is something really interesting for linguists like me and linguists like the ones working at the Max Planck Institute for Psycholinguistics. What is special about hyperpolyglots? Hyperpolyglots, people that speak more than 10 languages, that speak 20 languages, speak 30 languages. What is special about them? And indeed, there have been studies carried out in the last 10 or 20 years, unfortunately, not very statistically driven, but much more deductive, I would say. Now we want to work a little bit more with modern techniques in order to see what's happening inside the polyglot brain. And the hyperpolyglot brain is interesting because there may be something related to DNA. I don't know if Richard can help me, but I will hand over a small sheet of paper in order to gather, well, I will pass it over. So if you are a hyperpolyglot and you would like to participate in a study the next 2 years at the Max Planck Institute for Psycholinguistics and within the Language Interaction Consortium, I would be really glad if you can help me and give me your details so we can contact you and we can invite you to Holland and to our laboratories. Obviously, we're not gonna use you like rats. No, it's very funny indeed, because these are gatherings in which we let people speak and speak and speak. Maybe we will just ask you to get some saliva or things like that for DNA, but nothing more. Or, well, an fMRI study. You already saw, if you were in the presentation 2 days ago, that we do brain-related potentials, and we work also with that in linguistics. And we actually want to see what's happening in the brains of hyperpolyglots. Because, well, actually, the human language computational system exists, but we want to see how different, if it actually fits different, well, how different it works in the brains of hyperpolyglots. So, well, if you're a hyperpolyglot and you want to help me with a study on hyperpolyglottery, please be my guest and write your name in that sheet. I will hand over. I don't know if you have a sheet.
Send an email.
Well, if you're, that might work, I think. I don't know, but sometimes you tell people that.
Come to me if you're interested, and you can put your name on a piece of paper, I'll keep it. If you don't manage to get to me, then just write me a message and I'll pass it on. Okay?
This research will be done within the, well, with the sponsorship of the Language Interaction Consortium in the Netherlands. We're looking at different aspects of language diversity, not only hyperpolyglottery, but also variation of language variation in small indigenous communities in South America, in Africa, in Asia. We're looking at language genes, we're looking at language in birds, songbirds, etc. Well, this is where my presentation ends, and I would, well, thank you very much for the invitation, thank you very much for your time, I hope to see you next year. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you very much. We've got 15 minutes for a few questions. Anybody got any questions they'd like to ask?
Okay, first of all, I want to thank you for a really amazing and really informative presentation. So you're a linguist, you've shown us a picture, you told us that you, we've seen that you sit down with those people, you actually write the grammar of the language into the laptop. I've just always wondered how you people do that. I mean, I'm sure there are a lot of exceptions in the language. like an exception to every rule, which native speakers can't really think of at the moment. So I'm just wondering how you go about all those. I mean, how do you register and, you know, write down all those exceptions to grammar rules that native speaker really can't think of when you're talking to them?
Okay, you mean in terms of a second language speaker, or?
Well, yeah. Well, you showed it that you sit down with them, you really talk to them, I believe, and speak to them.
Well, indeed, when we first look at it, it's a language competence. So we let people speak. We're not involved. Otherwise, it may be biased, right? But we first of all want to test how good a speaker speaks this or that language. So first we will see if you actually have an advanced level of this or that language. And for that, we all obviously have grammars of all the languages we're working with, right? In this big lab, we have grammars of almost all of about 2,000 languages. So it wouldn't be that difficult to test competence, at least for the specialists. I wouldn't be the one doing the experiments because I'm part of a sample as well, so I cannot tell you now, but I can ask them later.
Yeah. I'd like to go back to the field linguistics part of what you've done. Many long years ago, I tried to learn something of Quechua and Aymara in South America, and it was an absolute abysmal failure. I could not get anybody to speak with me. I went to Cusco and Machu Picchu and Lima, and I bought all sorts of grammars for Quechua. I did a homestay with a family where the lady said she was a native Quechua speaker, and I asked her to read some things for me and make some recordings. I took a bus and a train up to La Paz. I bought books for Aymara. I tried to find people. Absolute failure. Nobody would speak Quechua or Aymara to me, not one single word. I hiked the Machu Picchu Trail. The porters who carried the bags, they were speaking it. The second I got close, they shut up. They only spoke Spanish. How do you do it?
Well, first of all, what you're saying is true. In these two languages, especially Quechua and Aymara, there's a great language disloyalty. Since they are descriptive, especially Peru and Bolivia are countries in which Indians are discriminated. So they are discriminated not only because of being Indians, indigenous people, but also because of speaking a different language. And because of that, they feel very ashamed when they speak their own language. So when they see a foreigner, they feel ashamed of speaking Quechua or Aymara, and they prefer to speak Spanish. That makes us language learners fail when we want to learn these languages. Fortunately, now things are changing in Peru, especially in Peru. I can say something about Peru because I am Peruvian. So we are putting TV spots. We are going to the field in order to promote the use of Quechua and tell the speakers that actually the languages are very valuable and that they don't have to be discriminated. Where we have put on the internet many documentaries on the history of these languages, and this situation is changing. We even have at the Catholic University in Peru, a whole cathedra in Quechua, so you can learn the language there. And also, we have also summer field schools in Quechua-speaking territories now. So I would say that the situation has changed, and if you really want to try again, don't be disappointed. I think you wouldn't be disappointed, because I think you would have a lot of chance to have success now with Quechua studies. I can put you in contact with many good people there. It's true what you say, and in my case, it was like that five or six years ago. But then I went there and started living with them, and they said I was a linguist, and I actually had to record things for my own grammatical purposes, so I ended up learning language. But yes, like 10 years ago, it was really problematic, and even linguists were saying that Quechua was going to disappear. Now things are getting much better.
Any other questions at all?
One of the theories I've heard about hyperpolyglots is that some of their abilities are because they use other parts of the brain, like the face recognition system and things like that. It has been up a name in connection to the brain of rats, which was gotten modified and analyzed. which are your current theories about that?
Well, this is kind of controversial, but what we actually think is that there is, well, what we suppose, because we don't even think that, is that in terms of genetics and the DNA, there is a special interaction of several genes which are acting differently in polyglots and which act different also in left-handed people and people with some language disabilities like dyslexia or, and it's kind of related. You don't believe in it? No, but indeed, it's really interesting because we find we get results, we might also be able to study these other aspects of these language impairments as well. So I wouldn't say it's insulting. It's interesting from a scientific point of view. It's a talent that has to be studied, and it was actually a taboo for a long time, and we are just trying to get rid of it. And see what actually is happening. Maybe nothing's happening, who knows, and they're just the talented people or people that are really motivated, which is also possible. But we need to check that, first of all, before saying anything.
I don't mean to ask a controversial question. I'm not familiar. Why is it considered offensive or so controversial to do this particular study?
Well, every time you do research with people, you have to be ethical, and you have to ask permission to people to do that, because you may find many things, right? So I'm still not in, I'm not in the field of genetics and linguistics related to genes, but obviously we might find many things related to polyglottery or hyperpolyglottery. We found many left-handed people which are hyperpolyglots in the past, and that is also statistically significant, and also people with Asperger. So we want to know how related are these parts of the brain or these parts of the genes, or how these genes interact with these people. Because obviously, this doesn't mean that all hyperpolyglots are left-handed and all hyperpolyglots are autistic and all hyperpolyglots are whatsoever. It just means that there's the interaction of some genes that have actually something to do with these language processes or with language in general. And that is the interesting thing. But it's controversial because you deal with language impairments. And yeah, obviously, if you work with someone that has Asperger or autism, you have to be careful and ask for permission, these things. That's why it's a little bit controversial.
I think we can have one more question if any would like to ask something. Okay, so thank you very, very much for that. We're going to leave the paper at the back for anybody who hasn't signed up for the study. At the moment I've been passing it around, so we'll just leave it at the back on the counter where the drinks have been served. So if you want to take part in the study, then you can sign up there. Okay.
Richard, you're going to be part of the study as well, right?
Yeah, you can come and join me. Yeah. We'll go and rave up in that.
Richard and Emanuele already. Yeah. Our volunteers for the study. Yeah.
Yeah. And anybody watching the video, of course, because this is going to go up online, yep. So you can contact either, probably best to send a message to me via Facebook. You can go to my Speaking Fluently Facebook page, or you can send me a message probably privately to Facebook if you want to, and I'll check my other inbox if you're not one of my friends. For this next few weeks.
But I can also send an email to luismiguel.berscia@mpi.nl, and yeah, that would be also.
Okay, we'll put some links down anyway in the comments, so in the description, so that you can get in touch.
Well, again, thank you very much for your time.